Oh, my Lord, you search and you know me. You know when I sit, you know when I rise. You know what I think, you know where I'm going. Nothing, oh Lord, can hide from your eyes. You close me in, behind and before me. You shield me with your mighty hand. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too much for me to understand. Where can I go to flee from your spirit and from your presence? Where can I hide? Behold, up in heaven, you're there beside me. In the depths of the darkness, you're by my side. And if I rise on the wings of the morning, or settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, for your right hand is holding me.
Let's start with a prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Yahweh, you examine me and you know me. You know when I sit, when I rise. You understand my thoughts from afar. You watch when I walk or lie down. You know every detail of my conduct. The word is not yet on my tongue. Before you, Yahweh, know all about it. Thank you very much, Jesus, for the gift of faith and for the gift of so many people throughout the Old and the New Testament who have taught us how to address you, how to address the Father, how to pray at all times and in all situations in life. We pray that through these new series, we may be able to draw closer to you and we may be able to discover the greatness of the faith that we have. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, now, and ever shall be, or without end. Hi, everyone. Welcome to our new series. I'm not very sure if you were looking forward. We have been looking forward for this new series. It's been a few weeks, right, since we stopped the previous series, and it took a few weeks to get back to this series, Pray with the Word, Pray with the Psalms. So, praying with the Psalms, we will start today and we will continue for the coming 5 weeks. And the breaking of the word for today and the subsequent weeks will be centered on a specific psalm. We can't take many psalms at one go, right? So we are going to take one. And the psalms, when we look at them in general, they are prayers of the Old Testament people. And that is precisely the reason for the wide variety of content in the Psalms. Some Psalms address God in time of anguish, persecution, times of peace and rejoicing. Others express how the psalmist is going through a rough time and feels abandoned. Yet, whether happy, sad, or angry, the Psalms are prayers coming from people of faith with a deep conviction that God listens to and answers prayers. The purpose of our School of the Word is to pray, to learn to pray with God's Word, to to dive into God's word and to be able to enjoy a personal encounter with him through his word. Hence, praying with the Psalms teaches us to address God, to pray to him, no matter the situation we might be going through, whether, like the psalmist, whether it's a happy time, whether it's a sad time, whether we are feeling angry, whatever the situation is. Today, for the first session in our series, I invite you to pray with Psalm 139. If you were attentive to the song is very marching, right? So maybe we had to rush through the lyrics. But the psalm is precisely singing Psalm 139. So depending on the translation of the Bible you have, this psalm's title is The All-Knowing God, The Inescapable God, in praise of God's omniscience, which means all-knowing, right? All-encompassing God. And the psalm begins with a profound statement. In fact, this is one of my favorite psalms. There are 100 over psalms, right? But this is one of my favorite psalms. And from the beginning, the psalmist introduces us by saying, "Oh Lord, you have searched me and you know me." This first verse introduces us to God, who knows us, who knows me personally, and who knows us, each one of us, deeply. Not a stereotype of or a partial knowledge of ourselves, right? God knows us the way we are. And he, knowing us, approaches us. In a way, you know, we recognize that God knows us and he knows us from within. This knowledge is comforting because God knows us and accepts us fully. Otherwise, he will move away from us, but he doesn't. That means that he knows us and accepts us fully for who we are, not from whom we appear to be, not from a stereotype or from a partial knowledge or from the opinion of people, but God knows us deeply. That's the reason why I find these words very, very comforting. That the knowledge that God has from each one of, for each one of us is so deep, so real, and yet so accepting. He accepts our imperfections, our complications, our shortcomings, our incoherence, or lack of love. But he also knows all the suffering we carry in our hearts. And our life's potential. He knows everything, the good and the bad, you know, the hurts, the suffering that we carry within us. And he doesn't judge us. To know someone in the biblical language means to love that person. Jesus also in the New Testament talks about mutual knowledge or love between the shepherd and the sheep. And he says in the Gospel of John, "I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me." This passage speaks of mutual love. He's talking about knowing his sheep, about loving his sheep because he knows them. And he also says that they know him, means they reciprocate that love. And that's precisely the kind of relationship that God invites us to have with him. A relationship in which we are known by God, we are loved by God, accepted by God, and also a relationship in which we slowly get to know him better. This passage of John speaks of the mutual love between God and the people, the sheep and the shepherd. When Jesus says, "I know the Father and the Father knows me," he is talking about the love between God, the Father, and Jesus, the Son. So Even though we can't go to the exegesis and see the words in the original language, the words that are used to define this love, we know that the love that God has for us is a love that goes beyond our understanding at times. Because how to love someone that is at times so difficult? Or how to love someone that at times is so elusive? Because sometimes that's how our relationship with God. But God knows us and loves us. The reality is that we cannot possibly love what we do not know. The more we know God, the more we know a person, the more we love them, and the more our acceptance for them grow. Hence, the need to know ourselves and God. If we want to love ourselves, we need to know ourselves. If we want to love God, we need to know Him. Not at a superficial level, but as deep as possible. And our relationship with God can go as deep as we want. I mean, we always would like to have a relationship with God that goes deeper and deeper. But that's precisely the purpose of prayer, that we can grow in our knowledge of God and that we can grow in our friendship with God, in that experiential knowledge that helps us to love Him more and more. The psalmist says, "You know when I sit down and when I rise. You discern my thoughts from far away." I like very much these lines in the psalm because I think that sometimes people find it very difficult to know us and to grasp what we are thinking, right? Sometimes our thoughts can be so convoluted that we don't even know what we are thinking about. And yet, the psalmist says, "You discern my thoughts from far away." God can discern what is going through our minds, through our hearts. There are times in our lives, especially when we go through difficult moments, and that we think that God has forsaken us. Those are the thoughts that are in our mind. Or perhaps we think that God has forgotten about us. You know, He's so busy with so many things. He's so busy because the world is so messy and things change so fast that God has to catch up. So we think that God has forgotten about us, that we are not that important to Him, and that He has left us to face life's challenges by ourselves. There is this passage in the book of the prophet Isaiah where God addressed the prophet who was going through a similar situation, right? A situation where he was feeling dejected, where he was feeling abandoned. And so God says, Zion was saying, "Yahweh has abandoned me. The Lord has forgotten me. Can a woman forget her baby at the breast, feel no pity for the child she has born? Even if these were to forget, I shall not forget you." And I think that this comparison that the prophet uses is a very unusual situation, right? When a mother would forget her baby. But he says, "Look, I have engraved your name on the palms of my hands. Your ramparts are ever before me." God doesn't forget about us. Even if someone like a mother can forget her baby, and we know that it happens, we know that there are mothers who abandon their children, God doesn't abandon us. And He sees all what we go through. And He says, "Even if a mother was to forget her baby, I will never forget you. I shall not forget you." And this is a promise of God. And the reason is because He has engraved our names in the palms of His hands. That's the reason why God has always us in His mind. We are always present to Him. In God, there is no past or future. Only the present exists. Because God is not limited by time and space as we humans are. In God, there is no past and there is no future. There is only present. And we are there. Our life is all present to Him. That is how much God loves us, that his love is constant and uninterrupted. That is the reason why the psalmist says, "Where shall I go to escape from your spirit? Where shall I flee from your presence? I will say, let the darkness cover me, and the night wrapped itself around me. Even darkness to you is not dark, and night is as clear as the day." God knows us and is always with us in our today, in the present. He is the all-loving, all-embracing, all-encompassing God and Father. I'm not very sure how is your experience with your father, but I'm a daddy's girl. I was very close to my father, and to experience the love of God in this way, all-loving, all-embracing, all-encompassing, has always gave me this sense of security, and has always given me this sense of security, because that's precisely how I felt with my father. And to see that God is also all-loving, all-embracing, all-encompassing, beyond the human love of our parents. The psalm also says that we are all wonderfully made. We are his beloved children, created out of love and for a purpose. These words of the psalmist express how awesome God's love is for each one of us. In the eyes of God, our lives and our existence are willed and deeply loved by him. My existence, your life has been loved and willed by God. No one is a coincidence or a mistake, or even someone undesirable. The all-knowing and all-embracing God who created each of us, created us for a purpose, with a meaning, for a purpose. Knowing him personally and as he is, in that way, we will find the greatness of our life, created in his image and likeness. The more we know him, the more we relate with him, the more we get to love him, the more we will find the meaning and the purpose of our lives. It will become clearer for us. What's the purpose? What's the reason why God created me? Why he gave me this life? Why am I wonderfully made by God? And this always brings me to words of that Benedict the 16th said. He says, and I quote, "Each of us is the result of a thought of God. Each of us is willed. Each of us is loved. Each of us is necessary," end quote. These words of Pope Benedict resonate deeply with me. Sometimes when we think that we could be here or we might not, that will make no difference. That is a lie. When we look at our lives from the perspective of God, to think that we could be here or we might not and that will make no difference, that is a lie. God has willed us to be who we are and where we are. And no one take our place or do what we have been called to do. Each of us, may have received a very different vocation, a different mission, but we have been given a purpose. And only when we get to know God profoundly does this purpose become clearer and accurate. And then we can walk with certainty in life. We live for such purpose, not as an obligation. Whatever the vocation and the dedication or the path in life God has, given us, we will not live it as an obligation, as a burden, or as an imposition. Because as the psalmist says, God leads our steps in his ways. We will be able to understand the ways of God and the purpose and the reason why sometimes we go through challenges, through joys, through difficulties, and sometimes through situations that in our eyes might not have much meaning. And I would like to share with you my personal experience of praying with this psalm. I know it will sound like a granny story, because the first time I came across this psalm, I was 16 years old, like long time ago, right? And it was during a silent retreat at one of our Bible Day retreat houses, which is near my city, Mexico. And that is the highest mountain near my city. So it's at 2,500 kilometers above sea level. So it's kind of like high. And you can have a very beautiful perspective of the city, and you can see the city from far when it's night. So I remember that I was in a retreat, and it was a very beautiful sunny day. I was in a silent retreat, so I was by myself praying. And it was a very sunny day with a clear blue sky. I was outdoors because this psalm talks about the height, the depth, and the awesomeness of God's love. And as I was there, you know, in this beautiful place, contemplating the immensity of the place and the beauty of nature, I felt deeply known and embraced by God. I still remember as if it was this morning when I had that experience. I remember that sense of feeling overwhelmed by the embrace of God when I realized that nothing I said, nothing I think or feel or have lived or live is away or unknown to God. That He knows and that He knew me and that He was able to understand me. That overwhelming sense of being deeply known by God was such an awesome experience. Not only was it an awesome experience, it was also a turning point in my life, because it gave me this deep desire to know God more and better. Because if He knows me, I thought, if you know me so well, I also want to know you. And this experience gave me this desire to know God more and better, to be with Him no matter what life could bring. And after all, I knew God would be with me. Because I still remember that moment of prayer when I said, it doesn't matter what happened to me. It doesn't matter where I go. It doesn't matter what is God calling me to do. He will be with me. And that gave me also this sense of security. And yeah, that experience was a turning point in my life, because I realized that nobody else can know me better than God knows me. Nobody else can know my fears, my anxieties, my joys, and nobody can be with me everywhere I go but God. So that experience really gave me this sense of truly our God is all-knowing, all-embracing. And this is precisely the experience that God wants to give us. Praying with the Psalms is this experience of allowing the words of the psalmist to tell us who God is in times of joy, in times of discovery, in the times that we go through in life. So I would like to invite you today, as we enter in this time of prayer, to invite you to read the psalm in a prayerful way. Read, you know, slowly, and stop in the verse or the line that speaks to you of God at this point in your life. It might be rediscovering that you have been wonderfully made by God, and to accept and love yourself as you are where you are. It may be that experience of God all-knowing, all-embracing. Whatever the experience that God wants to give us, let us allow Him to say those words to us, to you personally. And let's, like the people in the Old Testament, believe that God listens and answers our prayers from the heart. So I'm going to flash the passage, and let's take this time of silence. Let's read slowly the word of God, allowing Him to talk to us.